This is all about the 8th Air Force, these books. And I've read all these books, John. Ah, what do we got in here? Hey, come on, Dad. That's a big book. That's about
That's a nice book, Jack.
And you know the nicest thing? This is signed.
Yeah.
By David.
Yeah. This is a nice
and
book.
And I get a Christmas card every year from him.
Yeah, it is a nice book.
And then the nicest thing I like about it, see, there's his name.
Yeah, and it's very informative too.
And then I got to show you. You like it, it's in somewhere in England by the land. And then the nicest thing, is that the first page? No, that's the introduction and stuff. This is still the introduction. Come on, where you at here? Get through the introduction.
Little old Jack Spratt, 92nd Bomb Group. I remember vividly the way it was and the last day I saw it.
Yeah.
Jack Spratt.
Yeah.
92nd Bomb Group.
That's right on the first page.
Beautiful story.
I didn't know he was going to put that on. Yeah. It was just like when we were walking along and he was taking all these notes. And he's went taking all. He's taken.
He took these off Doc's farm.
Yeah. And, in that one place we were at, I don't know whether he took a picture. So you got this. It was clever. And then the one room that we were in, which was where they did the finishing cars, you know, where the paint
place.
Yeah,
where the big picture was.
Took the picture of that he's got in here. It's just, the guy that went along with us on a trip, you know, there, and did all of that. And of course, he talked.
George Walshman.
Yeah, he talked to each one, and there's a letter from him.
See, you said to me, Jack, did you say you remember George Walshman painting that?
Oh, yes.
And what do you remember about him, Jack?
Well, he was a. That was in this bag, wasn't it? He was a chap, just like all of us, so you know. He wasn't any older than me, which would be like most of us. I was like 23, going on 24, and he was the same. The most that I knew about him was that when he was painting a picture in the latter part of 44, probably the first part of 45, in December, and we were in this where the picture is in what we called at that time a day room. Where we could go play pool or play cards or sit there and be sociable and have a Coke or something like that. I believe that sometimes the USO ran the organization that was there, which the USO was pretty prominent. And Red Cross people were more prominent than maybe the USO, but they were always coming having something. And John, you know, you've seen them, the buildings over there, there were Quonset huts. I better wait my piece. And Quonset huts that were just like a barrel cut in half.
Nissen huts.
And in the end of it was this brick wall. And of course, I think the one that he put it in that was either a barracks type thing, you know, a square building up.
We're talking about the big picture.
Big picture now, yeah. And it was right up in the front.
Yeah.
And it was in a brick wall.
Yeah.
And I would say, just from now remembering the size of it, it had to be at least 10 foot or 12 foot up and down. It was almost like a square. And it was painted on a brick wall in there. And the only heat that you had in there was one of those little potbelly stoves in the middle of that.
And he used the paint, was regular paint off the base, was it?
And then he would come back, the paint that he was... had put on some of it where he was painting at the different colors. He would come back and set that on that top of that little potbelly stove.
Keep it warm.
Yeah. And then I sat there and watched him paint it, quite a bit of it. And I'd sit there by the stove to make sure that nothing happened to the paint and stuff. I didn't really know him, but got acquainted with him because he was from Indianapolis.
How long do you think it took for him to paint that?
To paint that, it probably... He didn't do it in just one day.
No.
You know, how you know how it is now. He kind of took the border around, and then he filled in like most painters will do. They'll start something, and then they'll say, well, I'm getting tired. And that's when they'll quit, because they didn't want to make any mistakes.
Yeah.
And then he'd paint, he didn't paint that in just one day.
Yeah.
Took him about, I would say, altogether maybe 30, 35 hours
yeah.
of each time he'd paint it. But he would never leave the paint there in the building.
What sort of time of the year was it he done it?
That was in the latter part of, I always said it was the latter part of November into December, but it was more in...
what year, Jack?
1944 and 45.
Yeah.
And he started painting that in December. I thought he painted it earlier, but from some of my records I got, I know that it was in the latter part of December.
Yeah.
You could say, well, Christmas time, before that, just a little bit, and that went into January.
And what was he? Remember, 326. Was he 326?
No, I think he was 325th.
325th.
325th. I didn't know him from prior to that, other than getting acquainted with him.
What was he? Was he a waist gunner or what was he? Do you know?
I always thought he was a tail gunner.
Tail gunner. Yeah. But, yeah.
Because I don't have any writings on him except all that I knew that when I took the picture that time and remembered his name, Walt Schmidt.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's right down in the right-hand corner, and that's what he would do on his pictures. And the only reason that I had any knowledge of that picture was they made a paint shop out of that, well, taking all the dents and everything out of the car. And when I went back, I don't know, it was 89 or 91, one of those days. When I went back, I just got up on the hood of one of those cars, which was still there in that, which we originally called a day room. Well, we'd go play cards, play pool, or whatever you wanted to play, or just sat there and listen to the radio or whatever. And they had some old cars still yet in that building. I stood up on the hood of I don't know what kind of make of cars you had over. But it was one that had been in a wreck, and they'd never quite finished it. Maybe the people that owned it kicked them out. Maybe they didn't pay their rent. I don't know. But I stood up on the hood and took it. And I didn't realize that I had got his signature on that picture of the plane.
Mm.
And when I had it developed, when I got back home, they made it up into a big 8x10 picture for me. And you could see right down the corner, Walt Schmidt, where he had signed it.
Mm. Well, it's nice to have met somebody that actually knew George Walt Schmidt.
Well, that's great, because I happened to be over there when they had put it on a trolley.
Yeah.
I didn't get to see it taken into
low loader. Yeah.
A museum, or where they took it into
Duxford.
Duxford Museum, and that's probably there to this day.
Yeah, still there, Jack.
From what they told me, they cut that right out of the brick wall.
You braced it.
And that's the original.
Yeah.
And then they touched it up.
That's it. It's all braced.
I wish they would have left it just like it was and sprayed it with a clear...
They spoiled it, Jack.
Yeah.
Yeah, it did.
Because if you'd see the original picture that I took in its originality, and then I have the other picture they took, and it's just like it's... redone.
Yeah. The paint was flaking a little bit, but that's okay.
And that could have been sprayed.
Of course.
And it could have been retained in its region. It's like I tell you, John, on my jacket.
Yeah.
Somebody said, well, take it and have it cleaned. Yeah. Well, it has 39 missions on it, and it's got
sweat
and everything on it. It's in its originality. If I would take it and have it cleaned, that would all be gone.
That's all part of Jack Spratt when he was a young lad.
Yes, right. So it just made... Make something, I like to keep it in its originality. It's like